Hey everyone, welcome to Homeschool. Hope everybody are doing good. And today I have come up with this preparatory question paper for Karnataka Board 10 students. Okay, so as you all know, the question paper pattern paper is divided into three parts, isn't it? Part A, that is physics, part B is chemistry, and part C is biology. So today I will show you how to write the answers for all these questions, and especially some of the physics questions are very much conceptual. Biology questions need to be written in a proper way, right? So I'll be showing you how to present the answer for a particular question here. And don't miss out the video, guys. This will be the most helpful video for you to improve your presentation for final examination, which we're supposed to held on 29th or 30th of March, right? Fine. And coming back to a video, first let me discuss about the questions that come under part A. Okay, so we all know part A is of physics, right? All the questions are from physics side. So first let us try to discuss these MCQs. So question number 1, question number 2, and question number 3 are MCQs, right? See, the device that converts electrical energy into mechanical energy. So definitely, I think this is the question repeated from model question paper that was released last month, right? So we all know the answer for this. It is electric motor. Okay, so electric motor converts electrical energy into mechanical energy, isn't it? So whenever a current carrying conductor is kept in between magnetic field, a conductor experiences a force. As a result of the force, the conductor moves in a certain direction, right? So we make the things move with the help of electricity, right? So that is the major principle of electric motor. So definitely here the answer is option B, isn't it? And coming to question number 2, guys, the element used in making a solar cell. So definitely this is a direct question. You can go for the option D, that is silicon, right? And question number 3, at the time of short circuit, the current in the circuit reduces substantially, does not change, increases heavily, varies continuously. Definitely you can go for option C, that is increases heavily. So during the time of short circuiting, see, whenever live wire comes in contact with a neutral wire, what happens, you will observe a path with low resistance is getting developed, isn't it? So in a circuit, there creates a path with least resistance. So when you have something with least resistance, you know, more current, more and more current can get passed through it, right? So that is what we mean by short circuiting. So here we are going for option C, that is increases heavily. And now coming to 1 mark question. Question number 4 is 1 mark question. What is electric current? So it's a simple definition, everybody can answer. Rate of flow of charges is called as electric current, right? Fine. And coming to question number 5, they have given a figure here. Okay, a bar magnet is inserted into a coil and withdrawn as shown in the figure. Mention the principle that found here. So definitely this is a Faraday's experiment, coil and magnet experiment, right? So all these Faraday's experiments were to prove electromagnetic induction. So they are asking you what principle is involved in this experiment, right? So definitely you can write this word electromagnetic induction. Electromagnetic induction. Just this much is enough. You no need to write the definition of electromagnetic induction. In case if you have written the definition, that is also fine. Okay, see, what is electromagnetic induction? It is nothing but a current gets induced when a conductor is kept in a changing magnetic field, isn't it? So that is called electromagnetic induction. You can just write this word or its definition. So both are fine for the answer. So now coming to 2 mark questions. So 6th question is a diagram they are asking from physics part. Very simple. Draw the schematic diagram of an electric circuit comprising cell, electric bulb, ammeter, and plug key. So very simple diagram, isn't it? So comprising bulb, okay, and a cell. So let me take this as positive and this as negative. Cell they asked, so only one positive, one negative, and a plug key. So you have to show a plug key, and also you have to show a ammeter. Okay, so ammeter you can show, and the direction of current is always from positive to negative. So this is the direction of current. That's it. So this carries 2 marks. Fine. And coming to question number 7. So this is also very simple question from human eye. Observe the given figure, name the eye defect indicated in the figure, and mention the lens used to correct this defect. What are the reasons for the defect? Okay, see, name the eye defect. Look at the figure. The image is formed in front of retina. So if the image is formed in front of retina, then the defect is myopia, right? Myopia, short sight, short sighted defect. So it means myopia in the sense people can see objects at near distances, but people cannot see the objects which are kept at far distances. So that is what we call myopia. In case of myopia, the image is formed in front of retina. If the converging takes place exactly on a retina, we can see the things. But here, the converging of refracted rays are taking place in front of retina. Okay, so that's what we can observe from the figure. So we are done with predicting the eye defect. Then what else they are asking? Which lens do you use to correct this defect? So definitely here we use what? Concave lens. Okay, so concave lens we use to correct the defect. And what else they are asking? What are the reasons for this defect? So definitely you have to write the reasons. Excessive curvature and elongation of eyeball. Okay, so reasons. Excessive curvature of lens, or you can also write elongation of eyeball. So this can be your answer. Okay, so that's all about question number 7. And coming to question number 8, very simple question. Write 4 characteristics of good source of energy, they are asking. So you have to write the 4 points. Okay, so what is the point number 1? Large amount of work has to be done by a unit volume of fuel. By a unit volume of fuel or unit mass of fuel. Okay, and the second one is it should be easily accessible, right? And the third point that you can write is it must be easy to store and transport. And the fourth point is it should be economical, that means cheaply available in a market. Okay, so these are the 4 points you can write, guys. And there is a OR question here. Write the effects caused due to overuse of fossil fuels. Okay, so let me write that answer here. Effects caused. So the first one is, we all know fossil fuels are non-renewable sources of energy, right? So they are non-renewable in the sense they are exhaustible. They are exhaustible source. That means one fine day they will get over. Okay, so that is why we have to use them in a limited way. Okay, and the second point you can write is using fossil fuels causes pollution, especially air pollution, right? So when the fossil fuels are burnt, oxides of nitrogen and oxides of sulfur are released into the environment. So they are the dangerous gases. And not only that, when fossil fuels are burnt, carbon dioxide is also released in the atmosphere, which is nothing but a greenhouse gas. Okay, so this is how you can present the answer in a point wise. So that is all about question number 8. Now let us go for 3 marker question. See guys, question number 9 is highly conceptual question. You must definitely know the concept for this, and you should also know how to present the answer for this question. Okay. See, let me read out the question. Explain an experiment to show a current carrying conductor experiences mechanical force when the conductor is placed in a magnetic field. Okay, so you have this experiment in your textbook, right? So you can roughly draw a diagram like this. See, when a aluminium rod AB, which is connected to a battery, okay, and a plug key, okay, so this is kept in between magnetic field. So what happens is, as current flows through this aluminium rod AB, which was in magnetic field, okay, it will experience a force. Actually, this is the principle for electric motor, right? Yes. So it will experience a force. So about that force and how you have done the experiment, everything you should explain in a point wise. Okay. So maybe the points that I have written on a board will help you out to write the answer. If you want, you know, you can take a screenshot or you can pause the video and write the points yourself in the notebook. Okay, so let me read out the points that I have written. So look at here. Like I told you, I have roughly have drawn the diagram. And then look at the first point. Small rod AB. So this is a rod AB connected to battery and placed in between magnetic field. MF in the sense magnetic field. Okay. When a current flows in BA direction. So current is flowing. So this is a positive terminal. So positive terminal is actually connected to end B. So current is flowing in a rod in BA direction. Okay. So when a current flows in a BA direction of rod, it experiences force. As a result of this, it displaces. The rod gets displaced. The rod moves somewhere. Okay. And the third point, the direction of the force depends on the direction of magnetic field and current. Okay, it can be identified by Fleming's left hand thumb rule. See, if you want, you can write the definition of Fleming's left hand thumb rule in the next point. Otherwise, you can leave your point here. Okay, but do mention that direction of mechanical force can be identified by Fleming's left hand thumb rule. And later, last point you can look at here, direction of force gets reversed if the direction of I changes, right? See, the direction of force actually depends on the direction of current and direction of magnetic field, right? So if their directions are changed, force direction also gets changed. So these are the four points I think it's enough to mention. Say, if you want to add one more point, if you are not satisfied, you know what you can write is Fleming's left hand thumb rule definition. You can write it as one more point. So that will be sufficient. Okay, more than enough. So this is how you can present the answer, guys. See here, most of them would be knowing the concept. Okay, so definitely we know that whenever a rod is placed in between a magnetic field, that too current carrying conductor, when placed in between a magnetic field, it will experience a force. But they are asking, how do you show it through the experiment? So presentation is more important. What points you write and how you write is important. Okay, so I think this is a very much conceptual question. Most of you would feel to answer this question difficult, right? So anyway, so this is how in the easiest way you can present the answer. Fine. And coming to question number 10 here. Okay, it's a ray diagram. Like I said, at least one ray diagram from light chapter is compulsory. It will be there in the question paper for 3 marks. Practice all the ray diagrams properly. Okay, see, question number 10 is very simple ray diagram, right? Draw the ray diagram to show the image formation by a concave mirror when the object is kept between C and F of a mirror, right? So they asked you, it is a concave mirror. So this is our concave mirror, and if this is a P, this is a principal axis, and here let me put F, and here is C, right? So what they said, the object is kept in between C and F. So it is in between C and F. Okay, so if this is one incident ray which is parallel to principal axis, and that would move through principal focus, reflected ray, this is one reflected ray. So the other one, if I move it through F, and it will move through, you know, it will be parallel to the principal axis, right? So this is second incident ray, and this is our second reflected ray. See, both are meeting here behind C, right? So the image is beyond or behind, beyond C. And what is the nature of the image? Definitely it is real and inverted image. okay, real and inverted, and enlarged, it is enlarged also. Okay, so this is the ray diagram, neatly you have to draw. Fine. So coming to question number 11, okay, explain the experiment conducted by Newton to show that white light contains 7 colors. See, white light contains 7 colors. How do you know that? When you pass white light through a prism, you will observe the white light getting split into 7 colors. That is what we call dispersion of white light. Okay, so that was mainly discovered by Newton. So Newton's experiment, you know, with the 2-prism experiment he has done, isn't it? We also call it as recombination of white light, right? See, this is 1 prism, he passed incident radiation, splitting of light occurred, and 7 colors will get split like this. Okay, and all the radiation, when you pass it through a inverted prism, all of them would combine and it will come as a white light itself. Okay, so this is that experiment they are asking, and you have to draw this figure and then mention the points below. Look at the points that I have written. Newton used glass prism to obtain spectrum of sunlight. Second point, 7 colors of white light split in a prism. Okay, so you can add here, this is called dispersion of white light. Okay, so that sentence also you can add. And later, third point, he placed second prism in inverted position with respect to first. This allowed all the colors to pass through second prism. He found a beam of white light emerging from other side of the prism. So this way, he has discovered splitting of white light into 7 colors. Okay, so that sentence you can add and conclude the answer. So that's all about this question. And look at this OR question. So this is very, very conceptual. Explain the relation between the color of scattered light in the atmosphere and size of the scattered particle. On the basis of this relation, explain the reason for blue color of the sky. Very much conceptual question. Okay, so in NCERT textbook, if you read carefully, so there they have mentioned this point that, you know what, our atmosphere contains small molecules, oxygen, hydrogen, and all these gases are very, very small molecules. Okay, usually small molecules, small particles, let me write it as particles only. These atmospheric gases are very small molecules. I am calling them as small particles. Okay, small particles always scatter. Okay, the radiation with less wavelength, okay, fine. And now, among the colors violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, and orange, the less wavelength is for violet, indigo, blue radiations. Okay, so they have less wavelength. So lambda is the symbol for wavelength. Okay, and red radiation is the radiation with high wavelength, high lambda. Okay, so what I just now told, our atmosphere is made up of small particles. So these small particles always scatter the radiation with less wavelength. So, okay, which is the radiation has got less wavelength? These radiations, right? So that is why the smaller particles, since our atmosphere is made up of smaller particles, you know, these smaller particles scatter blue radiation. Blue radiation which has less wavelength, and so sky appears blue in color. Okay, so this is how you have to mention the answer, guys. Okay, so very much conceptual question, isn't it? But still very, very important. So each and every line of NCERT is very important, guys. Okay, so that's why in science, reading NCERT is must and should. When you read NCERT textbook thoroughly, line to line, you must you will get an idea how to present the answer, and you can clearly get what exactly the answer for a particular question. Okay, so scoring 100 always depends on how nicely you read NCERT textbook. So guys, I recommend you all to read NCERT properly. Okay, fine. And now let us go for the next question, that is question number 12, and it is a problem, right? So usually the problems are very, very easy nowadays in the question papers, right? So here you have two problems from the chapter electricity. So one is on resistance, okay? So the other one is on Joule's law of heating, isn't it? So let us try to solve those problems one by one. And coming to the first question here, the resistors R1 is equal to 2 ohms, R2 is equal to 4 ohms, and R3 is equal to 4 ohms. Okay, so they are connected parallel. So they are connected parallel, and they are connected to a battery which has got 6 volt. Voltage is 6 volt. Then calculate the total resistance. So they are asking total resistance is how much, and also total current is how much. Okay. So definitely they are connected in parallel. All three are connected in parallel. No? So to calculate the total resistance of a circuit when they are connected in parallel, first you write the formula 1 by Rp is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3. Okay, so writing formula is must and should. And now you substitute 1 by R1. R1 is 2, R2 is 4, and R3 is also 4. So take the LCM, it is 4. Okay, so 2 plus 1 plus 1. Okay, so you will get Rp is equal to 4 ohms. Sorry, 1 ohm, isn't it? 4 by 4, it is 1. So 1 ohm. So 1 ohm is the total resistance. So now they are also asking you the total current, right? So we know the Ohm's law. V is equal to IR. So I is equal to V by R. So V is given, that is 6. Okay. And R just now we have calculated 1. So I is equal to 6 amperes. So writing units is very, very important. For resistance you have to mention ohm, and for current you have to mention ampere. That's it. Now coming to the sub question B, 200 joules of heat. Heat is given, that is 200 joules. Okay. Then what else is given? Is produced in each second. That means time is equal to 1 second. Each second in the sense 1 second. Okay. Resistance is given 8 ohms. They are asking potential difference across the resistor. Potential difference. V they are asking you. Okay. See, look at here. We have a major formula. H is equal to I square RT. Right? Fine. See, here R is given. T is given. So what do what they are asking you, V they are asking, but we have this formula, right? H is given. So instead of I, we know the Ohm's law, V is equal to IR, right? So I is equal to V by R. So in the place of I, I'll substitute V by R. So what do I get? V square by R square into RT, right? So V by R whole square, in the sense V square by R square. This R gets cancelled. So H is equal to V square by R into T. See, look at here. T is there, R is there, H is there. We have to calculate V square. So rearrange a formula. V square is equal to H into R divided by T. Okay, so what is H? 200. R is how much? R is 8. Okay, divided by T is 1. So 2 8s are 1600. V square is equal to 1600. So V is equal to square root of 1600. That is, V is equal to 40 volts. Right? So 40 volts is the answer. So this is how you can calculate that B question. Okay, so coming to question number 13. So this is also very, very simple question. Easily you can get 4 marks, isn't it? Write any two differences between convex and concave lens. Always differences question, write in this format. Okay, so this is a convex lens and this is a concave lens. Okay, do you remember? This is how you represent the convex lens, no? So concave lens is what? This is concave lens. So what is the first point of difference you will write? Okay, ends are thinner here, but here ends are thicker, right? Ends are thinner and thicker in the middle. Thicker in middle. Okay, so whereas here, thicker ends, okay, and thin at the middle. So this point you can write. And the one of the very, very important point is this is a converging type. Okay, so this is a converging lens, and whereas this is a diverging lens. Okay, so any point you can mention. And one more point, here you will have real and inverted images, and here always erect and virtual, isn't it? So that point also you can write. So they asked any two points, so I limited to these two points. Coming to question B. This was question A, right? So now question B. A ray of light traveling from air enters obliquely into water. Okay, so here you have water, and here you have air. So air, we know it is a rarer medium, and water, we know it is a denser medium. Okay, so now incident ray is striking obliquely, and definitely this is our normal. So they are asking, does the light ray bend towards the normal or away from the normal? Definitely it bends towards the normal. Okay, so it bends towards the normal, because it is entering from rarer to denser. Why they are asking? So why is it bending towards the normal? It is because the speed of light changes. Okay, so speed of light in the water is less as compared to speed of light in the air. Okay, so what is your answer? Speed of light in water is lesser as compared to air. Okay, so this can be the answer. Very simple, right? So this completes our physics part. Now let us go for part B, that is chemistry. Coming to part B chemistry, 14th and 15th questions, 14, 15 and 16 questions are MCQs, right? So they are also very much direct and easy. Coming to 14th question, calcium oxide reacts vigorously with water, right? Calcium oxide, when you add water, it reacts to give calcium hydroxide, isn't it? So they're asking, what type of reaction is this? Is this decomposition, combination, displacement or double displacement? Definitely you can go for option B, that is combination reaction. Okay, so reactants are two, product is only one. So this is the definition of combination reaction. Coming to question number 15. So they have given some structures. Among them, they are asking which among them is unsaturated carbon compound. Definitely you can go for option A, right? So in option A, you have a structure of benzene. So if you carefully look into the structure of benzene, between carbon atoms, you have got a double bond. So whenever you have double bonds between carbon and carbon, okay, then you can confirm that it is unsaturated hydrocarbon. Coming to question number 16, calcium is there, titanium is there, potassium is there, iron is there and zinc is there. So they belong to same period, they said. They belong to same period. Okay, so if you can remember the period, it's not necessary to know about titanium, iron and zinc. But look at the calcium, potassium, you are very familiar with these elements, right? And these elements belong to which period? Fourth period, isn't it? So they all are fourth period elements, okay? And they are asking, which is the element that has got largest size? Okay, so look at here. We all very well know that group 1 elements have got the largest size compared to all other elements. So among them, you just think which one is coming under group 1. Definitely you can go for potassium, isn't it? All are in same period, guys. But now you just check it out, which among them belongs to group 1, because group 1 elements are largest. Right, so here you have this potassium which is belonging to group 1. So you can go for option C. So where is potassium in the option? It is in option C, right? So that way you have to carefully pick the answer. Okay? And coming to question number 17 here. So there is this reaction 2AgBr giving Ag plus Br2. This chemical reaction is endothermic reaction. Why? Because this reaction needs sunlight, right? It is a decomposition reaction, thermal decomposition reaction needs sunlight. So whenever energy is required for a reaction, then you will call it as endothermic. Okay, so that should be the answer. So now question number 18. So they're asking you, mention two limitations of Newland's classification of elements. So limitations, the first limitation you can say that Newland's theory is applicable. So write it point wise, guys. So first point you can write as, the theory is applicable only till calcium, only till calcium. So after calcium, it's that what is this principle? Every eighth element must be similar to the first one. So that will not get applied after calcium, right? So this is the first point. And second point is, did not leave any gaps. Did not leave any gaps in his periodic table. What if some elements discovered? So you should have gaps in the periodic table, right? For the newly discovered elements. But this Newland did not give any gaps. So that is also one of the limitation you can write. Fine. So now question number 19. How ethanol can be converted into ethanoic acid? So this is from carbon and its compounds chapter, oxidation reaction, right? So ethanol, chemical formula CH3CH2OH. So this one should get converted into ethanoic acid, that is CH3COOH. So you have to write the reagent, guys. So what is the reagent you will write? Alkaline KMNO4. KMNO4, this is the reagent you have to mention. So this is the chemical equation for that. Just write the chemical equation along with the reagent over. And coming to question number 20 here. Write one difference between oxidation and reduction reaction. Okay, so oxidation one side, reduction reaction one side. So they are just asking you only one difference. So what you will write here? Addition of oxygen. Addition of oxygen is called oxidation. And here, removal of oxygen. Removal of oxygen is called reduction. Isn't it? Fine. And write an example for each type in the form of chemical equation. Okay, so what example you can write? Mg plus O2 will give you MgO. This equation you can write. So you should always write balanced equation. And here for the reduction, what example you will give? H2 plus S will give you H2S. Okay, addition of hydrogen. So this you can give it as an example. Okay, fine. Over. Next, 21st question, guys. What are neutralization reaction? Reaction between acid and base. Reaction between acid and base, right? To give salt and water. To give salt and water is called as neutralization reaction. How can any solution be identified as neutral by using litmus papers? See, litmus papers colors will not change, right? So red litmus paper if you have, do not change to blue. Do not change to blue, right? Or if you have a blue litmus paper, it will not change to red. It will not change to red, isn't it? So there is no change in the color. So that way you can identify whether a solution is neutral or not neutral. Okay, so now there is this OR question for 21st. So they are also very simple questions. Okay, what are alkalis? Write two uses of sodium hydrogen carbonate, that is baking soda. Okay, a soluble base, or the base that is soluble in water is called alkali. Okay, 21st question. A soluble base is called as alkali. Over. Next, write two uses of sodium hydrogen carbonate, that is baking soda. Uses of baking soda, that is NaHCO3. Right? So, first point is it can be used in bakeries to make fluffy and soft cakes. And the second one is it can be used as antacid also. Okay? So, these are the two uses you can mention. And coming to question number 22 here. So, they have given some information. Group number is there. Third period, all elements they have mentioned. Which of these elements have plus 1 and minus 1 valencies? So, plus 1 valency is shown by group 1 elements. So, which is a group 1 element here? Sodium. And minus 1 valency is shown by 17th group element. Here, which is a 17th group element? Cl. Argon is placed in the 18th group element. Why? Because argon has completely filled shells. Okay, completely filled shells are there. Okay, so it has got 8 electrons in the outermost shell. That is why it is placed in the 18th group. And it is a noble gas. It is a noble gas, inert gas. Okay, so that's why it is placed in 18th group. So this way you can write the answer. And coming to 23rd question, it is a diagram from chemistry part, which is there for 3 marks, isn't it? Diagram of arrangement of apparatus to show acid solution in water conducts electricity. So this diagram, you can draw it carefully. Okay, so I am not showing it on the board. You can just refer the textbook for that. Okay, and coming to question number 24th here. Magnesium forms ionic compound with chlorine. Why? Explain. Okay, see, magnesium is a metal. Okay, it always loses electrons to form cation. You have to show it. Mg. Okay, so which has got electronic configuration 2, 8, 2. Okay, it will lose 2 electron. After losing 2 electron, it gets converted into Mg plus 2, which has got electronic configuration 2, 8. And this is called as cation. Okay, and later chlorine. So this chlorine is a non-metal, right? It is a non-metal, always gains an electron to form Cl minus, which is anion. Okay, so whenever cation combines with anion, you will get an ionic compound MgCl2. So here one cation combines with two anions, you will get MgCl2, which forms a ionic compound, Okay, so this is how Mg can combine with chlorine. Okay, and there is this OR question. Aluminium oxide is an amphoteric oxide, whereas sodium oxide is basic oxide. Why? Okay, aluminium oxide is there, no? Al2O3 can react with both acid and base. So that is why this is amphoteric, right? You have to show the chemical equation. So you have learnt this chemical equation, right? Aluminium oxide, when it reacts with acid, what do you get? Aluminium oxide, when it reacts with a base like NaOH, what do you get? So here you will get aluminium chloride plus water. Similarly, here you will get sodium aluminate, NaAlO2 plus water. So these two chemical equations you can write. And now, sodium oxide is not amphoteric, it is basic. Okay. Sodium oxide is metallic oxide. It is a metallic oxide. Okay, it can react only with acid. Okay, so that is why this is called as a basic oxide. If you want, you can show one reaction. Say sodium oxide, treat it with some acid like HCl. What do you get? You will get NaCl plus H2O. whereas this aluminium oxide is reacting with both acid and base, that's why amphoteric. Whereas this sodium oxide, it's only reacting with acid because it is basic oxide. Bases can only react with acid, right? But when this has both characters, it can react with both acid and base, right? So that is the difference between aluminium oxide and sodium oxide. So this way you can write the chemical equations also. Now coming to last question from chemistry part. So that's a 4-mark question. Under 26th question, first let me explain this A question. Carbon atom neither loses nor gains the electrons. Explain this statement scientifically. Okay. See, carbon never loses electrons. See, if it loses electron, it should lose 4 electrons. Okay, it should lose 4 electrons to become C plus 4. Whereas if it gains electron, it should gain 4 electrons to become C minus 4. But both of them will not happen due to small size and high ionization energy. So these are the reasons, guys. So why it cannot lose electrons to become C plus 4 and why it cannot gain electrons to become C minus 4 is because the carbon is very small and it has got high ionization energy. Okay, it can only share the electrons to form a covalent compounds, but it cannot form ionic bond, right? Fine. And coming to the B sub question, how are esters formed? You have to show the chemical reaction. Esters are formed by the reaction of one alcohol, that is ethanol, when ethanol combines with ethanoic acid CH3COOH, okay, in presence of acid like HCl, what happens? From ethanol, this hydrogen, from ethanoic acid, this OH comes. Next, join this piece to this piece. You write the product CH3CH2. What is left out if you remove H? O is left out. Now add this part, not this carbon, this part you add. That is CO. And beside this you have CH3. And this is what we call ester. Sweet smelling esters. Okay. And how can soaps be obtained from esters? Right. So from esters, how do you get the soaps? If you add NaOH to ester. Okay. So that was the ester. Let me write the formula of ester. CH3CH2OCOCH3. Okay. To this, if you add NaOH. If you add NaOH, okay, so you will get CH3CH2OH plus bond will break here. This side H gets added and this side ONA gets added from NaOH. So you will get CH3COONA. So this is what we call soap. Isn't it saponification reaction? So they're asking, even if you don't mention the equation, just you tell by saponification reaction, soaps are formed from esters. Okay, you can use this word saponification reaction. By saponification reaction, soaps are formed from esters. So that way you can mention. Over. So next, let us go for OR question also here. Look at here, under OR question, observe this A sub question. Carbon and its compounds are used tremendously as fuels. Explain the reason for this application. Okay, see, it is due to combustion reaction. Okay, so you have due to combustion reaction, what happens? Large amount of heat and light are liberated. Okay, heat and light is released. okay? Since large amount of heat is released, it is used as a fuel, okay? For fuel is meant for burning, right? So large amount of heat must get released, that is the quality of a fuel, right? So you can give one example here. Suppose if you take methane, when you treat it with O2, you will get CO2 plus H2O are the products. Along with that, large amount of energy gets liberated. So this is the answer for that. And coming to B sub question, how do micelles form while cleaning dirt by soaps? So you have to explain the points of cleansing action of soap and just show the diagram of micelle, guys, right? So this is, if you think this is a dirt, around the dirt particles, okay, soap will come and form a kind of special structures called micelle. Okay, so micelle formation you should explain in one or two points. And then how can soap be, next one more question, continue question is there. Why do soaps forms come with hard water? It is because of the presence of calcium and magnesium ions. Okay, if you know the chemical equation also you can show it here. Okay, or you can just leave the answer like this. It is due to the presence of calcium and magnesium ions. Okay, so that's all about the chemistry part. Actually, none of the question here is so difficult, right? Everything, if you know the concept, you can easily attempt all the questions of chemistry part. They are all very easy. So now let us move on to biology section, that is part C. 32nd question is from control and coordination chapter. Functioning of reflex arc is more efficient than the thinking process of the brain. Clarify this statement with scientific explanation. See, look at the two points I have written on a board. Exactly the same way you can present the answer. See, the reflex actions are more convenient. So they are more evolved because thinking process of brain is not fast enough. And the other one is, many animals have little complex neuron network. So their network of neuron is not that good. Okay, so they have very, very little network of neurons. Actually, that needed a much thinking process, right? So many animals have little complex neuron network needed for thinking, right? So these are the two points you can mention as an answer. Coming to the next question, guys, quite a conceptual question, 33rd question. Okay, so let me discuss 33rd question here. Construct below given types of food chains that comprise algae, aquatic birds, larger fish and small fish. Okay, so you have organisms like algae is there, okay, and aquatic birds, and then larger fish and small fish. Okay, so these are the organisms you have in a particular food chain. And they are asking you to arrange these organisms in the increasing order of energy. Okay, food chain that shows the flow of energy in the increasing order. First one is, you have to arrange them in the increasing order of energy. Okay, so definitely look at here, algae is a producer and a small fish is a primary consumer, right? Large fish is a tertiary consumer, and whereas aquatic birds are quaternary consumer. Okay, so fine. See, producers will always have more energy, right? And quaternary consumers will always have less energy, right? So first you write down this, something like this: algae, producers, okay, aquatic birds, quaternary consumers, larger fish, tertiary consumers, small fish, primary consumers. Now you arrange them in the increasing order of their energy. So among them, least energy is shown by aquatic birds, right? So aquatic birds Okay, so after that you have tertiary consumers, that is large fish. Okay, so after that you can write small fish, and later highest energy you will observe in the producers, that is algae. So this is the order, guys. Since I don't have a place here, I have written down, but you write it straight. Okay, so aquatic birds have least energy, later large fish, small fish, and highest energy you will observe in algae. Okay, and second one is, second sub question is there. You should arrange them in the flow of harmful chemicals in increasing order. So increasing order, harmful chemicals will always increase from producers to primary consumers, primary consumer to secondary, secondary to tertiary, tertiary to quaternary. So quaternary consumers will have highest amount of harmful chemicals, isn't it? So what you will show here, algae. So algae producer having least chemicals, and after that primary consumers are small fish. So after that you will go for large fish, and after that you will go for aquatic birds. So this is the increasing order of chemicals present, and this is the increasing order of energy. Okay, so conceptual question, and people can able to write this, but this one you have to be careful, it's the ulta order you have to write. Okay, so that's all about question number 33. And coming to question number 34, see, many times this question was asked, and this is the expected question itself. Explain the role of small intestine in the human digestive system. So you have to tell what the bile juices does in the intestine, and you have to tell the role of pancreatic enzymes one by one. See, bile juice, which helps in the emulsification of fats, right? Pancreatic enzymes, all of them, you have pancreatic lipase, you have pancreatic amylase, and trypsin is there, and mention their role, and finally you tell in small intestine complete digestion of fats, carbohydrates, and proteins takes place. Not only that, you have to mention about the absorption of nutrients with the help of villi. Okay, so the pancreatic walls have a small finger like projection called villi. So these villi will absorb maximum amount of nutrients, and then it will pass it on to a blood. Okay, so you have to tell about the digestion, complete digestion of carbohydrates, proteins, and fats with the help of these enzymes, and later mention a point about the villi, which helps in the absorption of nutrients. Okay, so point wise, if you can write the answer, it is best. There is our question also. Our question is also very simple. So they are asking, what is the role of nose and alveoli? Okay, so you have to tell what happens in nose. You have thin hair like structures, so they will help in purifying the air, right? So in case of any dirt or in case of any harmful microorganism, the hair will the hair will not allow those microorganisms and dust particle to go into trachea. So that way nose can protect, the fine hair inside the nose can protect. So that point you can write. And alveoli, write its definition. It is a sac-like or bag-like structure, okay, which has a very big surface area, so that maximum amount of oxygen can be absorbed, okay, from alveoli. Alveoli is connected with the blood vessels, so the absorbed oxygen will move on to the blood vessels. So this alveoli helps in the exchange of gases, right, between blood and lungs. So here the definition of alveoli and its function. So here what happens inside the nose, if you can write, that will be a perfect answer. Okay, fine. And coming to question number 35 here. Okay, so this is much simple question. So this also point wise you can write easily. What are hormones secreted by the following glands? Write one function for each. Okay. See, they have mentioned three glands and you have to tell which hormone is secreted in them and what is its role or function. So, coming to thyroid gland. Okay. So, you have this thyroid gland. So, definitely in thyroid gland, a hormone called thyroxine is secreted. So, what is its function? It helps in the metabolism of fat, right? Carbohydrates and proteins. So, this is the function of thyroxine. And next gland is adrenal gland. So, adrenal gland has a hormone called adrenaline hormone, right? So, which helps in emergency. Okay, and also it can help in controlling heartbeat. Okay, so this you can write. Coming to the third endocrine gland, that is testis. Okay, so testis will produce the hormone called testosterone. Okay, so it will produce testosterone, which help in developing secondary sexual characters in males. That's it, over. And there is this OR question also here. OR question is also very simple. What is geotropism? Which part of the plant shows negative geotropism? Write the functions of the following hormones. Okay, what is geotropism? Geotropism is growth in response to gravity, right? Growth in response to gravity is called as geotropism. And they are asking which part of the plant shows negative geotropism. Okay, so negative geotropism is shown by shoot. Okay, so shoot shows negative geotropism. And they are asking what are the functions of the following hormones? Auxin. So, what does the auxin do? Auxin help in the growth of shoot, and it can help in the cell elongation also. And cytokinins are helpful in cell division. So, they are helpful in cell division. Abscisic acid, right? So, abscisic acid is helpful in wilting of leaves, and you can also write that it helps in inhibiting the growth. That point also you can mention. So that is all about 35th question. Now coming to question number 36. Look at this 36th question, a sub question. How did Mendel identify the tall trait as dominant and short trait as recessive trait in the experiments conducted on pea plants? So, very simple. You have to explain the monohybrid cross here. That's it. Okay. So, take tall plant with dwarf plant. Okay. So, write its genotype. Take it as homozygous tall. You crossed with the homozygous dwarf. So, in the F1 generation, you will have small t, capital T. Okay. So, that means you will get all tall plants here. All tall plants. So this shows that okay, tall is dominant, so expressed, okay, in F1 generation. Okay, and T is recessive. T in the sense what? Dwarfness is recessive. So did not express in F1 generation. That's it. So this is for this only 1.5 mark. Just show this and write this sentence, more than enough. No need of showing F2 generation. Okay, if you want to show, you can show it, but that's not necessary. Till here, you can show your answer here and you just mention this sentence. This is important to mention. Okay, so now question number B. Give an illustration to prove that the complicated organ such as eye evolved in stages. See, look at the points I have written. Complex organs such as eyes are created bit by bit over generation. Okay. In primitive species, I mean in the old species, there were no such thing called eye. But in intermediate stage, that is in planaria, there developed two eye spots which were called as rudimentary eyes. Okay. Which gave fitness advantage. And later gradually, if you look at humans, slowly in humans, we have binocular eyes. Okay, so with these binocular eyes are more complicative, which can see the things. Okay, with the help of eye, we can see the things, right? So that's it. This much you can write as answer. Okay, so that's all about 36th question, guys. And then coming to 37th question, it is a diagram of human heart and they asked you to label upper vena cava and left ventricle. So you can do that. I'm not showing a diagram here. And directly I'm moving on to a 5-mark question, that is 38th question. What are the differences between the fragmentation and regeneration methods? So just write their definitions itself, guys. Fragmentation is what? Under suitable conditions, organism splits up into fragments and each fragment develops into new organism. And what is regeneration? When an organism is cut by chance or by accident, each cut piece is developed into new organism. Okay, so just their definitions you can write. 2 marks you will get, 1 point for this and 1 point for this. Okay, and next there is a continuation. What is the reason for increased accumulation of variation in sexual reproduction? So increased accumulation of variation is because of, due to errors in DNA copying. Next continuation question for this. What is the reason for increased accumulation of variations in sexual reproduction? So why do variations occur in sexual reproduction? It is due to errors in DNA copying. Okay. Coming to the B sub question. Why menstruation occurs in women? Explain menstruation, how it occurs in women. So this is very simple, write 2 points here. Okay, when egg is not fertilized, fertilized, what happens? It degenerates, egg gets degenerates, okay, and thick uterine lining breaks and comes out as blood and mucus through vagina. Okay, so this can be our answer for that question. So that's all, guys. So this is about the 38th question. So that's all about the video. So as far as my opinion, 2 questions in bio and 2 questions in physics. In bio, there is this question, right, about the evolution of eyes in stages. Question number 36B, illustration, how do you prove complicated organs such as eyes evolved in stages? Say, you may be knowing the concept, but you will fail in the presentation wise. Okay, so there you have to be careful. And the other question in biology, which is little tricky, and you will get confused, is question number 33. They asked you to construct food chain, no, in the increasing order of their energy, right? So that is that ulta order you should write, right? So there you will lose a mark if you are not careful. Other than that, in bio all questions were easy. And coming to physics, same thing, you may fail in presentation, that's it. Question number 9, explain an experiment to state a current carrying conductor experiences mechanical force. So points you have to write properly. And question number 11, that or question is there, no, relation between the color of scattered light and scattered particle. So if you know the concept, you can answer. Otherwise, you cannot attempt this question, right? So two questions from physics and two questions from bio are slightly tricky. Okay, otherwise the entire question paper is easier version itself. So that's all about the video, guys. Share the video with all your friends. Let everybody know how to write the answer and how to present the answer. And for your examinations, I'll come up with some live classes or some revision things in the future. Okay, for next 10 to 15 days. So thank you so much. Keep learning and all the best.